Hello everybody, I am Genaëlle de Julis. I studied mathematics and in particular number theory and their application in cryptology. And today I'm dealing with a part of work of Lenstra and Henninger work concerning RSAK. And I will do it from scratch. That is, I only intend of you that you know how to divide two integers. So let's go. First of all, I need to provide you some global overview of what is RSA. So RSA is an asymmetric cryptosystem. What does it mean? It is used, for instance, in your credit card to protect it. And asymmetric means that your two keys are required. One public, and you can share it all over the world. And the other one is a secret, and you should keep this secret. And where can we use an RSA cryptosystem? We can use it in two schemes. The first one is a signature scheme, when you want to sign a paper. So paper, in my case, it will be data. And the author signs the data using his secret key, so that anybody who have the corresponding public key can check the signature. This provides some nice security properties like authentication. This means that if the signature is valid, the author is authenticated, because only the author have the secret key. It also provides non-repudiation. This means that the author cannot deny that he knows the data he signed. And it also provides integrity, that is, the data are not compromised, we are not changed. So this is a first scheme, and we can also use RSA in an encryption scheme. Maybe you know this. For storage, you can use RSA to encrypt your own data. So obviously there is a mistake. The owner uses his public key to encrypt the data, and then he can send it in an untrusted cloud, for instance. Or you can use RSA to encrypt your data when you want to share it. And in this case, you will use the recipient public key. In this way, only the recipient could decrypt this because he knows the corresponding secret key. So in an encryption scheme, the only property you have is confidentiality. The data can only be decrypted by the person who have the secret key. So in this talk, knowing this, we can see that the key are important. So we will see how they are built. And where they are malformed, we will see how elementary division, you probably learned in small classes, can break some RSA key. And this is the work of Henninger and Lenstra. And after that, I will show you another application in the case of RSA encryption, when you want to send an email and encrypt the data using RSA. So let's start with the RSA case. First of all, I will explain you how RSA keys are built. All of what you have the habit to see is that it comes from the value of n. And for that, we need to select, first of all, two primes, denoted by P and Q. These two primes should be kept secret. What is a prime number? Maybe you don't know. For instance, 7 is a prime number, 11 is a prime number, 9 is not a prime number, 6 is not a prime number. So a prime number is just an integer. You cannot divide it by you cannot divide this integer by a number different from 1 and itself. So 6 is 3 times 2. It doesn't work. It is not a prime number. 7 is only divided by 1 and 7. So it's a prime number. Okay, this is the main part. If you understand this, you can understand all what follow. After selecting these two primes, you will compute three other integers. The first one is called the modulus, and is only the product of the two primes. After that, you compute two other values, E and D, related. And once you have selected the value of E, the D has only one possibility. So, and these two values are related also with the two primes. D is your private key, so you keep it secret, and E is the one you share all over the world with the modulus. So everybody know N and E, and use it to check a signature or to encrypt data, and only the owner of the secret key can sign data and decrypt a cipher. This is the main point. So you can see that all the parameters N, E, and D rely on the prime number P and Q. So without knowing those prime numbers, it is hard to recover D, and it is proved, mathematically proved. The second point is that RSA relies on the factorization problem. This means that everybody knows the modulus. So we know the result of P times Q. Okay, factorize it. 21 is 7 times 3. Factorize. So why it is difficult? It's only because the factorization problem is computationally difficult to factorize a huge number if the parameters are well chosen. So if the two primes are well chosen. And this is where is the flaw. So just remember, N is public, anybody knows it, and it is hard to factorize N. But can we find a workaround without factoring the modulus, but to obtain the value of P and Q, the two primes? Yes, we can, if we collect several modulus and we compare it. Compare it not to know which is greater than the other, but using something called GCD. GCD stands for Grid Common Divisor. Just take two examples to understand what is it. For instance, GCD of 1031 and 56 is 7. Why? Because 1031 is 7 times 3, and 56 is 2 times 2, 8 times 7. So they share a common factor, which is 7. This is the definition of the GCD. Another example with 42 and 56, you can see that 42 is 7 times 2 times 3, and 56 is 2 times 2 times 2 times 7. So you recognize that 7 times 2 is shared between the two numbers. So the GCD is 7 times 2, 14. This is the definition. But now, how to compute it automatically and without factoring? Because we cannot factorize the modulus. And in this case, in the two examples, I factorize the two numbers to find the most shared factor. To find the grid common divisor of two numbers without factoring them, there is a famous algorithm called Euclid algorithm, and sometimes young people learn the division using this algorithm. Maybe you don't know the name of this algorithm, but I'm pretty sure that you already practice it. So this starts like this. Take the biggest number, 56. And you try to equal it with 21 times something plus something else called remainder. So you find that 21 you can take times 2. You can't use real number, only integer. So it's 21 times 2 plus 14. And iterate it. You keep this number and you keep the remainder here, and you iterate it. 21 is 41 times 1, and the remainder is 7. And once again, iterate it, 14, and keep the remainder here, 7, times 2 plus 0. And once you find 0, stop it. And the GCD is the last non-zero remainder, 7, what we found here, by factoring the two numbers. For people who are more used with some code, this is the basic loop which Euclid algorithm make, and it's pretty fast, as you can see in a few slides, and it doesn't require to factor the number. So this is how Euclid algorithm work, and now how to apply it. Enninger and Lenstra did it in 2012, and collecting lots of RSA public key in only few hours, and how to collect it, for instance, in SSL certificate, in PGP mail, site mail, or connecting to SSH port, which is not filtered. The first request you make, the answer is a public SSH key of the server, the remote server. So it's pretty easy to collect it. And after that, they compromised to more than 12 million of the public key, the modulus, by the using the Euclid algorithm. How? Imagine you have two modulus, denoted N1 and N2. Remember that N1 is the product of two prime numbers, and N2 is the product of two other prime numbers. And reminder this example, I can always add times 1 at the end, it doesn't change the result, and this is the flow. What if your GCD between the two modulus is not 1? What does it mean? It means that they share a common factor, different from 1. If P1, Q1, P2, and Q2 are totally different, the result, the only factor shared, will be 1. But if not, it seems that you obtain either P or either Q. And just by division, you obtain the other factor. So you factor the modulus. And it is simple and fast. So problems, because once you have a GCD non-trivial, different from 1, you have a factor, division, you have the other factor, so you have the secret key, and you cannot use the modulus anymore. Everything is compromised. And just a small demo on two recent moduli. On their size, it was 124 bits. It's a famous online tool which benchmark RSA public key. You can ask it to Google. And the computation time, as you can see, is less, really few milliseconds. So, for instance, this is the first modulus, pretty long. The second one, the GCD, and no time appears because it's too fast. I need to make a loop to obtain an average time. And this work, I have the GCD different from 1. I test if the division allow me to recover the other factor. It works for the first one, for the two, and that's all. I have factored the two modulus. So, conclusion for this part. Just collect modulus from SSL certificate, for PGP key when you receive a signed email, or SSH key when you connect to a remote server, and just play. Just compute the GCD, and maybe you will find some shared factor. This often happens when a same provider provides lots of certificates, for instance, and has a weak generation of his prime number, and reuse it instead of renew all the prime number he already used. So you compute the mutual GCD. If you obtain 1 equal to 1, it doesn't work. And if it's different from 1, you just factor the modulus. So this is the main part of Enninger and Lenstra work. And now we can extend it in the case of RSA encryption. A bad way when you use RSA encryption in email. So first of all, I just explain how RSA encryption works to send an email. Imagine that Alice wants to send a message M to Bob. So she wants that only Bob can read it. So as usual, she will use the Bob public key to encrypt the content of the message and send it to Bob. Then Bob will decrypt using his secret key. Don't pay attention to this part. It's only to be correct, mathematically correct. And just the thing you have to understand is this is the notation for my cipher, and this is the message. And E is the public key. So now this is when Alice wants to send a message to Bob, and what happens if Alice wants to send the same message to multiple recipients? That is, she will encrypt first the message for Bob with the Bob public key in the cipher C1, and encrypt a second time the message with the Charlie public key, obtaining the cipher C2. Send C1 to Bob, C2 to Charlie, and then each of them will use their own secret key to decrypt their message. So just remember, C1 and C2 are two ciphers, and they encrypt the same message M. Okay. So now suppose another guy, Dave, just codes the cipher, the two ciphers, cipher 1 and cipher 2. And imagine that Bob and Charlie share the same modulus. N1 is equal to N2 is equal to N. And imagine that their public key, E1 and E2, are such that their GCD is equal to 1. So what can happen? Dave knows the value of N, of E1, and of E2. It's public. And he also caught C1 and the cipher 1 and the cipher 2. And let's reuse our Euclid algorithm, because it also provides something called Bezout identity. This is what the Bezout identity is in a mathematical way. Given two numbers, two integers A and B, you could every time find two other integers U and V such that this equality holds. A times U plus B times V is equal to the GCD of A and B. For instance, let's take our last example. The GCD of 56 and 21 is equal to 7. Okay, so Bezout identity say that we can find two integers here such that the result is equal to 7. And after small attempts, we can find that 21 times 3 plus 56 times minus 1, so minus 56, is indeed equal to 7. Okay, this is small attempts. It's not a huge number. So how can we do this automatically? And without finding the value of U and V, for sure, and without several attempts. We can do this using, once again, the Euclid algorithm in an extended way. This is what you showed previously. It is the Euclid algorithm. And I just write it in another way. Taken the remainder, and let's say it's equal to 56 minus this part. And I do it the same thing. I do the same thing with the remainder 7. Just 21 minus this part. And what I can see is that this 14, I can replace it by what is equal here. So just replace this by all of this block, just here. And gather the same number, because I want only 21 and 56. What 21 and 56, and gather these two ones. And we will obtain the value we found by small attempts. So is it clear? I hope. So you don't have to know how this algorithm work, because any software able to do mathematical stuff know internally this algorithm. Okay. So now, how to apply it on our case with Dave, who knows the value of N, the value of E1 and E2, the public key, and code the two ciphers C1 and C2. So the GCD of the public key is 1. we can find using our extended Euclid algorithm to integer U and V such that this is equal to 1. It's a there's GCD. And after that, what can he do? This is just the proof. And just take a look first at the code. I compute the extended Euclid algorithm of E1 and E2, Bezois identity, and just get in this way the two values of U and V. And then I compute this, cipher 1 to the power U times cipher 2 to the power V. Okay, here, these two lines, this is C1 to the power U and C2 to the power V, and then the product of the two ones. And why it provides the message is due to some basic rule on exponentiation you may have learned when you were young. It's because C1, if you remember, okay, C1 is m to the power E1. So C1 to the power U is equal to m to the power E1 times U. And you do the same thing with C2. E2 times V. And after that, since it's the same value m here, you can add the exponent. This is the other rule which is used. And once you add the two exponents, what you notice is that it's equal to 1 by computation. So equal to 1, this means that the result of this product is equal to the message. So in fact, your message is not securely encrypted because Dave don't have to know the secret key to recover the message. So what we learned a bit in this talk is that we have to pay attention to our RSM moduli first, because if the prime numbers are shared with other moduli, it's so easy and so fast to break the moduli. So just take care of this. And the second thing is that if you want to use an encryption for your email, for instance, be careful and use adapted software for this, because otherwise you can build a system in which you provide to anybody to decrypt the message without knowing the secret key. For instance, PGP, I don't know if you already use it, but PGP provides RSA key. Okay, and you encrypt your mail with this. So what I showed works, but in fact no, because the RSA key used in PGP is only to encrypt another key, which is a session key, which is used to encrypt the content of your mail. So what you previously see doesn't work in PGP. So it's difficult to build a system to encrypt data and share data. PGP uses RSA to build a key and AES, another crypto system, to encrypt the data. So thank you for your attention.